Good afternoon. Australia has lost a television icon with the death of Bert Newton at the age of 83. His beloved wife, Patti, leading the tributes, remembering her husband as a wonderful, loving family man. Reid Butler reports.
Bert Newton helped transform this old piano factory into Australia's television capital, Studio 9 in Richmond, also known as Television City. Today, the legend of the small screen is being remembered as a generous spirit and a tremendous talent. Wife of nearly 50 years, Patti Newton, leading tributes.
I would like him to be remembered as just a wonderful, loving family man that was also a bit of a legend.
Bert was someone who invited himself into the living rooms of Australians at a time when appointment viewing, and we all used to watch the same thing at the same time, some will remember that, and he was such a welcome guest.
The 83-year-old battled poor health for many years, but he never recovered from complications related to leg amputation surgery in May. He spent his final months surrounded by family. This photo, captured less than a week ago, Patti uploading the picture to social media with the caption, "This is what happiness is."
I actually don't know a lot of people in show business in his position that would cope with losing a leg and having a few jokes about it.
From on-screen antics with Graham Kennedy and Don Lane.
Remember that joke, look out for the Indians? What Indians?
To his many, many memorable Logies moments.
It is a pleasure to be here tonight. To introduce... Molly is actually kissing my wife, Patti, over there. A first for both of them. Well, there you go.
Bert Newton was among the country's greatest showmen, colleagues and friends lining up to share their memories.
If he was in a theatre, he would know the name of every person in that cast, not only the leading actors, but the doorman, the dressers.
He gave so much. He supported people when they were down. He encouraged young talent. Anyone who was anybody in the industry on the way up would get a message from Bert on their best day.
I joined in 73, 74, and, you know, he was always very welcoming and very popular with the workforce.
We've all lost the most admired television personality that Australia has ever produced.
Bert will be honoured with a state funeral.
And we will have a special tribute to Bert Newton on Nine tonight from 8:30, coming up after the block. Well, Scott Morrison has come face to face with the French president for the first time since the fallout over the nuclear submarine contract. Nine's political editor Chris Yeoman is travelling with the prime minister as he attends the G20 leaders summit in Rome.
This was always going to be a tough trip for Scott Morrison. He had to come because he'd faced domestic pain at home for not attending the Glasgow Climate Summit. But once he was here, he had to confront the fury of the French president. But it has to be said, it's the American president who's caused the Australian Prime Minister most grief when he said that he thought the termination of the subs contract was clumsy and graceless. And he also said that he believed that France had been kept informed that a termination was on the cards. Now, that's at odds with what the Australian side's saying. They're saying that they kept the American president informed all the way along, or at least they were talking to his people, and maybe that message wasn't passed through. And when Scott Morrison was talking about the handshake with the French president yesterday, he sounded a lot like a groom telling a bride that she would find love again one day.
He was having a chat to someone. I went up and just put my arm on his shoulder. I said, "G'day, Emmanuel," and look forward to catching up over the next couple of days.
The Prime Minister used this forum to again raise the need for another investigation into the origins of the pandemic, saying, of course, that that was the only way that we could prevent another one from happening, and that will no doubt anger China.
We need to know how this started so we can prepare and we can protect against the next pandemic. There is no agenda in that. It is just a very straightforward need that we have to best prepare the world for a future pandemic.
There was a grand dinner last night and a royal ring-in was assigned that from here the leaders will travel on to Glasgow and the International Climate Summit. But neither China nor Russia will be in attendance, and it's difficult to get an agreement on cutting carbon emissions when the world's biggest emitter isn't coming to the party.
Collingwood star Jordan De Goey has landed himself in hot water overseas, accused of groping a woman and attacking her friend at a Manhattan nightclub. De Goey and a friend were at the PhD rooftop lounge when they allegedly assaulted the 35-year-old woman. It's also alleged they glassed her male friend when he attempted to intervene. Both Collingwood and the AFL say they're attempting to make contact with De Goey. Victorian Liberal MP Tim Smith has resigned from Shadow Cabinet after crashing into another car while driving drunk. Smith was more than twice the legal blood alcohol limit when he struck another car in Hawthorne. In a statement today, the member for Q called it a serious error of judgment. His licence has been suspended for 12 months. Excitement is building in New South Wales with travel restrictions, international and interstate, set to lift at midnight tonight. Laura Tunstall is at Sydney Airport this afternoon. Laura, there will be some happy travellers there tomorrow.
There sure will be, Alicia. And we've got not only international destinations opening up, but also regional areas of New South Wales as well. And of course, it also means that for many Australians, they can now also come home a lot easier. And in fact, the first plane from LA to Sydney has already left. There are lots of excited passengers on board. And for the first time, those passengers who are fully vaccinated will not have to quarantine when arriving in Sydney. That's the first time that that has happened in 20 months. Now, there's also been a one-way travel bubble announced today between Australia and New Zealand. That means that anybody from New Zealand who is travelling to Australia will no longer have to quarantine. Unfortunately, it is a one-way bubble, though. If you are travelling to New Zealand, you will still at this stage have to do a mandatory two-week quarantine period. However, that will be reduced to 1 week in mid-November. Of course, for regional travel, it's exciting for all those holiday destinations in New South Wales that have really missed out this year. They are looking forward to welcoming tourists back with open arms. The town of Byron Bay is actually fully booked out until Easter next year, while on the south coast, which has been really hit hard with fires, floods and also COVID, is now reporting that accommodation there is booked out until the end of the year. Look, it is certainly very quiet here at the international terminal at the moment, but we are expecting it to be a hive of activity come tomorrow. And unfortunately, I have a shift tomorrow, Alicia, otherwise I would be heading out to buy a ticket myself.
I am with you. All right, Laura Tunstall there, thank you. Well, Victoria has finally hit the 80% double dose target 2 days after new freedoms were introduced. The key vaccination milestone came as the state recorded 1,036 new cases and 12 deaths, marking another drop in daily transmission.
They have really been our second front line. You know, we talk about our front line. Those people in the community have done extraordinary work to keep us safe. And I think that, you know, so many in our business community really have earned and deserve to be recognised.
It is the lowest daily case number Victoria has marked since September 28, when 929 new cases were recorded. A fishing trip south of Sydney has ended in tragedy after a boat overturned at Bulleye. Emergency crews managed to pull three people to safety while CPR was administered to four others. One man couldn't be saved and died on the beach. Three others are tonight fighting for their lives. Well, if you're out for a walk this afternoon, you may encounter a spooky surprise as ghosts and witches take to the streets. As Alan Rascal discovered, plenty of Australians, big and small, are getting behind the Halloween festivities.
Well, there's lots of creepy critters around, and that can only mean one thing, Halloween. Having previously lived in the United States, the Ajiro family loves Halloween and are always eager to share the occasion with neighbours in Australia.
Trick or treat!
What's Halloween like over there?
It was huge. It was really beautiful. Brought the community together.
And the kids can't get enough. Noah, why do you love Halloween?
I just love everything about it, and I especially love how we get to get candy.
Even the dogs take part. The modern day Halloween is said to have deep-rooted traditions from centuries ago that remember the dead. It's a social media dream. It's also big business. Halloween is the biggest time of the year for you guys.
Biggest event for us of the year, and we're so grateful to be open. Yay, go Victoria!
Be open to a scary night ahead. So what are you waiting for? Why not get caught up in the web of magic that is Halloween? Isn't that right? Yes, it is.